Okay, I'm going to give you a brief overview, and I have a lot of slides, so I might go fast through some of them. This is a project that I'm doing with several colleagues, Jeff Averne, Christine Markison, and Katie Simon, and it's called L'Homme de l'Environnement, and it's a combination of geophysics and GIS. So essentially, the project consists of three parts. We have part one, which I've been calling the Helvetii part of it. It's a large-scale model of long-term energetics, simulation of the subsistence economy of the Helvetii around the 2 years before 58 BC. And it's focused on energy capture, consumption, and exchange. And that's mostly what I'm going to talk about today. Part two is a Rhone frontier model, where we're looking at short-term energetics, a simulation of the Rhone frontier during the initial three-week encounter between the Helvetii and the Roman legions. And part three is the small scale, which is archaeological prospection. We're looking at remote sensing, geophysical identification of predicted archaeological signatures that would support or refute some of the contentions of the energetics models. We're also looking at several methodological questions. So this is the study area. It covers about 114,000 kilometers. And that's for the part one. The part two, the middle ground area, is the Rhone frontier, about 567 square kilometers. And Le Mandement itself, you can't really see that very well. But these are some vineyards on an area of a raised area called Le Mandement. And it's just outside Geneva, and you can see it's very close to the CERN. So one of the first things we had to look at is, I'm going to give a brief overview of the Helvetian War. And one of the first things I had to consider was, where is Helvetia? Where are the boundaries of it? And there's a lot of contention about where exactly the Helvetians live. And mostly they just say between the Jura and the Alps. And so we had to define boundaries for that area. But essentially the war began in 61 BC with Orgetorix, and there was a lot of political stuff going on. I'm gonna go through this really fast. But they planned to uproot their entire population and move to some location in central France. And Caesar claims that there were political reasons for this, and that there were these deals going on between the Aedui and the Sequani and the Helvetii, and there was a triumvirate of three wealthy nobles who essentially wanted to take over the Helvetii and attack the Allobroges, move into central France, and set up a triumvirate there. It didn't exactly happen that way, but what did happen was in 58 BC, the Helvetii were teamed up with the Tulingi, the Latobrigi, the Raurici, and the Boii, and they burned their villages and headed towards the Rhone River, where the Allobroge oppidum of Geneva was. And Caesar claims there were 368,000 people. So that's a lot of people getting up and moving across the environment. So the Rhone was described as the Allobroge frontier, but it's very likely that it was actually further on. Geneva, modern-day Geneva, occupied both sides of the river, and they controlled the bridge at Geneva, and that was an important economic and strategic objective. So the Helvetii were intending to go cross the Rhone and invade Allobroge territory. The Allobroge, they were allied with Rome, and they appealed to Caesar, and he brought in initially four legions, and they were joined later by two. Caesar was recently appointed the governor of Cisalpine and Transalpine Gaul. So the Romans come in, and they build an 18-kilometer wall, which we don't know exactly what the conditions of this were, how much of it was an actual wall, how much of it was, we know that there are earthworks that still exist. Some of them have been lost over time. Some of them have been eroded by the Rhone River. We have a series of castellum and other fortifications that were situated along this river. The Helvetii came, they stopped theoretically on Le Mandement, had encampments for about 3 weeks before they eventually were forced to pass through an area known as Le Pas de Cluse. And this shows a how steep the terrain is going through there. So they had to force their way through this defile. They went through and were eventually defeated at the Battle of Bibracte near Mont-Vaudrey. So the question is, Caesar claims that there were about 368,000 people, with about 92,000 warriors, and he claims this. There's political reasons for why he might have been exaggerating the numbers, and that's been a question that ever since Caesar went through there, historians have been debating. And other historians, such as Plutarch, beginning around 98 AD, and going through the modern era, have provided smaller and smaller estimates of how many people were actually in this population. And this chart essentially shows population breakdown by tribe. Caesar claims 263,000 Helvetii, 36,000 Tolini, etc. And then we go down to, I think it was Delbruck down at the bottom, who claims a total of only 100,000. So we have this difference between 368,000 and 100,000 people. So the question occurs to us, you know, what are the real numbers? And so this is, okay, this is the total population estimates. These are the number of warriors. These are the number of elderly women and children. And this is the number who survived and were actually relocated back into Helvetia later. So this generates a series of questions about the Helvetian War. Which of the historical population estimates is most accurate? And then what was the carrying capacity of oppida in villages in Helvetia? How far had they stretched their resources? Caesar was claiming this was a reason for them wanting to burn all their villages and take over Allobroge territory. And what was their system of energy capture, expenditure, and exchange like? Was the connectivity between settlements sufficient to support this energy exchange mechanism? Was it possible for internal or external energy exchange to raise the carrying capacity, et cetera? So the approach was to take on a large-scale spatial analysis where we wanted to look at spatial and quantitative parameters and generate a large-scale GIS model. And so this was where the GIS model comes from. It's a GIS-based simulation of the subsistence portion of the Helvetian economy, and it's a human energetics model. And a couple of things to emphasize that this is not a recreation, it's a simulation. So it's a simplification of what the subsistence economy was possibly like, or what we think it might have been. It's also not an active agent-based model or a multi-agent simulation. But there is agency entailed, and there are agents in the model, and I'll explain what I mean by that as we come to it. And the intent is to test specific hypotheses about the relationships between potential energy, kinetic energy, and the exchange of energy resources. And using these specific population estimates as iterations in the model. There's a bunch of other things that I can't really go into too much detail, but it does not include the production and exchange of craft goods, which might have gotten external calories coming in from neighboring groups. But that's a parameter we're going to look at with other iterations of it. So the information that we base this on, the parameters that we look at, are based on a huge amount of information on Roman and Iron Age economies. There's a lot of discussion and debate between historians. And so I've been sifting and rooting through all of this and taking out those kinds of parameters that I think will be actually useful within the model as I've designed it. And that means that this is constantly changing and updating, and I constantly have historians and other archaeologists saying, well, why don't you try this number? How about this number for this? And, okay, yeah, well, I'm building this as to be modular, so I can try any number that we like, but we can have a minimum range and a maximum range of virtually every parameter, and I'm making a lot of assumptions about them in each of these different iterations, and the goal is to find this middle ground where I don't put too much detail in, but I put enough detail in that it makes a convincing argument. And from a methodological perspective, there are a couple of previous models that people have done that are related to this kind of stuff. There's specifically two by Daniela Sova, which looks at the production of animal husbandry and agriculture and various things from a Celtic oppidum from pretty close to this time period in the Czech Republic. And then Dinter et al. Looks at the Limes area and looks at it from more of a large-scale land classification system and generating ideas about productivity through that. This approach is kind of a combination of both. It's looking at the specific productivity based on these ideas of animal husbandry, agriculture, collection, fishing, etc. But it's looking at on a larger scale over a series of different villages. So it kind of combines the two. So, what you can't see on this, but you might be able to see over there a little bit. We began with classifying a series of different kinds of villages. We are going to generate, or we generated the agents, the agent villages for the models based on a series of things. We have known locations of 12 oppida based on archaeological data. We know where these sites are. We know they were occupied during that time frame. We have another projected 55 village locations based on known archaeological or historical sites. And some of these were identified as Roman vici or vicuses or municipii after the return of the Helvetii, but also before. And then we projected the probable locations of another 194 villages based on the locations of known or existing Swiss settlements that have been in place for hundreds of years. And the remaining 151 villages were essentially put in to fill the voids, and they're based on the highest suitability for grain agriculture, animal husbandry, and other collecting suitability surfaces. So we're trying to give Caesar the benefit of the doubt and put villages in locations that are the most productive as possible. And then, so what we did was take their number, take his numbers and define them based on the number of agents in the model, distribute their population between them. And so we have total numbers of population at each of these village types based on Caesar's numbers, and then each of the other four historian estimates. So we have a minimum and maximum range that we can look at in terms of the total energy expenditure necessary to support this population. This is a map showing where we digitized the boundary of Helvetia, and the distribution of all of these villages based on types within that area, and then also the surrounding oppida and other villages outside in the Gaulish and Rhaetian areas. So these are essentially the model itself implies agency. It's an implicit agent-based model, and I'll show you how that works. But each of these locations are the agents in the model, and they represent a certain population based on historical estimates. So the model itself is really looking at this three-part type thing, looking between energy capture, energy expenditure, and energy exchange. And there's a series of subcategories that fall within each of these. And energy capture is potential energy, and it's based on dietary models, ideas about feedback and resilience, and carrying capacities. Energy exchange is the kinetic and thermal energy surfaces. It looks at transport and exchange, friction, systemic efficiency, connectivity indices, and energy expenditure is a kinetic energy based on local friction, population dynamics, etc. And this comes from looking at subsistence as a system. This is a representation of a simplified subsistence system in using energy systems language. And essentially you have an ecosystem, energy source, you have acquisition, storage, consumption, and lost energy. And what I'm interested in is that any energy not spent on subsistence goes into other systems. So that's non-subsistence energy. And I'm looking specifically at only subsistence energy. And then there's exchange with other groups as well. So the Helvetian subsistence economy breaks down this way. We have the ecosystem, which is livestock, crops, wild resources. They get transformed into available calories. Harvesting and processing takes out some of those calories. Some of them are unharvested. The low perishability items go into storage. High perishability items get consumed. Stored calories, some of it decays and is lost. The consumed calories, some of them are discarded. Some of them are burned in thermal energy. And then they also put calories back into agriculture, animal husbandry, habitat or technology improvements. Also, transport costs get sent into trade, and they get imported and exported with external groups. And there's also loss of crops or livestock, and all this other energy goes into other cultural constructs. There's also secondary products, which are things like produce that may be generated from the initial harvesting to go back into the act of harvesting itself. So these are the potential energy sources. I have about 48 different species or categories of livestock, produce, fish and lake sources, game animals, crops, grains, etc., gathered plants. And these are all broken down by total calories, fat, protein, and based on size, range, ideas about range and fecundity and all these kinds of things. And they're based on Iron Age estimates or estimates from that time frame. We have a bunch of different sources that talk about the size of cattle, for example, and other things like aurochs, wesent, Iron Age cattle, Roman Age cattle, modern cattle. And so all of these calories come from these age-appropriate periods. And those are broken down into dietary models. So I have a dietary model for each of the different village types, the oppidum, the lakes, the floodplain, upland, highland, and one for the Roman soldiers themselves, which I'm not really concerned about at the moment. These are broken down into sources of calories. So in the oppidum, their sources of calories are I have it broken down as 81% exchanged. So most of those are coming from other locations, but then there are some subsistence going on themselves, subsistence energy. And then each of these are broken down by livestock, produce, fishing, hunting, trapping, gathering, etc. And, coming back here. This is showing the diet sufficiency as well. So it makes sure that there's the appropriate representation between fat, carbs, and protein in the diet. So the data, the raw data sources come from the GIS data clearinghouse for the Swiss Confederation. I might have to transform the raw data sets into analytical data sets, which you can't see at all right here, but they're over there. And essentially, the raw data as it is isn't necessarily useful, and I have to transform it into something that actually is. And here's a couple of examples. This is precipitation, and this is temperature, and this is the way that they're generated by the Swiss data set. You know, there are these classifications. So I transform these into a decimal, standardized decimal surface ranging from 0 to 1, based on using some things like simulated rain shadow effect and a hillshade model to change the solar angle, changing the temperature into more of a decimal surface, and it's calibrated back with the original one so that it fits within that same range. And then I translate this into the temperatures for that period of 59 and 58 BC. And, oh, that's precipitation, actually. This is the temperature one. So same thing, modified temperatures based on the cumulative annular solar radiation, latitude and elevation, for example. So those raw data sets are transformed into these standardized data sets. And from that, generating these habitat surfaces. And then I use a series of friction surfaces as well. These are fairly simplified models of friction based on foot travel, ox cart transport, and boat travel. And they're based on a series of different formulas that are fairly straightforward. These are examples of the travel friction surfaces themselves. And green is easier travel, red is harder travel. That's foot travel, this is ox cart travel, and this is boat travel. And these are based on calories per 30 meters. And this is assuming a fixed amount of weight that's being transported. However, this is going to be transformed into a calories per kilogram surface instead. And the red area here, this for the boating, this represents, in fact, the movement of a certain amount of kilograms on water, but then when it's on land, it's either by foot or by ox cart. Then I have this these curves for kinetic energy. This is energy expenditure based on these different activities: non-subsistence, animal husbandry, agriculture, collecting, and then hunting and fishing at the bottom, collecting wild resources. And so that means all of the 100% of the energy for each of these activities falls under this curve with respect to cost distance from the oppidum or the village center. This cost distance is based on the foot travel as well, which is based on the terrain and the water flow rates if you're crossing the rivers, or if you're talking about travel on lake or waters. So these are some of the kinetic energy surfaces, and I just produced these last week, so they're kind of they're completely uncalibrated at the moment. But this is a surface representing animal husbandry, and the higher the red, the more energy is being expended in that area. So this is animal husbandry based on those formulas and the population estimates that Caesar has. And this is agriculture. This is collecting activities. This is hunting, and this is fishing. And this is non-subsistence energy. So it's highly focused on the village centers. And this is the total energy surface. So this is total kinetic energy as it's being expended. And the output.
The output will be. I can run into your questions.
Okay. Let me go through just the last couple slides. So that's. Actually, I think I can stop there. Yeah. Well, I'm also going to look at connectivity between the internal and external oppidum, for example. And ultimately, what I'm looking at is comparing the potential energy with the kinetic energy and lost energy and the exchange of energy across these surfaces to generate stress outputs, and then see if each of these historical population estimates, how they relate in terms of the total stress that's entailed by there being too much or not enough energy available. So ultimately, this goes back to being able to predict whether Caesar was lying or not about his population. And on the medium scale, we're looking at a series of other questions about the Helvetian War, including why the Romans might have placed castella and observation posts in specific areas. This surface looks at ranked river fording, for example. And this is a cumulative distance surface from the known castella to indicate possible areas where there might be other ones that the Romans built that we don't know about. Then on a small scale, we're doing the geophysics, looking at magnetometry and ground penetrating radar in some of these vineyards. So we have methodological challenges, working in vineyards, processing 3D GPR data, and identifying these short-term occupation anomalies. And basically that's it. The long-term objective is to predict where the locations of some of these encampments are, define excavation targets for future research, and partner with local universities and communities. Oh, okay, that's it.